Welcome to the Holistic Plastic Surgery Show, where we dive deep into the hottest trends in health, beauty, and cosmetic treatments. I'm Dr. Anthony Yoon, America's holistic plastic surgeon. Are you one of over 80 million Americans who suffers from hair loss? You may have noticed that your hair is thinning as you get older, and especially after menopause. Or maybe you have a parent who has lost his or her hair, and you'd like to prevent the same thing from happening to you. Well, if this applies to you, then you're in luck. You can reverse and prevent hair loss, and you don't necessarily need surgery to do it. On this week's podcast, I'm joined by the country's leading expert in hair loss treatments. We reveal the three most powerful supplements to thicken your hair, and we discuss today's wide variety of non-surgical, high-tech, and holistic ways to restore your hair. There is so much more that you can do to thicken your hair than surgery. So let's get started. My guest this week is a board-certified hair transplant surgeon and graduate of New York Medical College. He has treated over 17,000 patients and performed over 8,000 hair transplant procedures on patients from all over the world. He's a fellow of the International Society of Hair Restoration Surgery, and one of only 100 physicians worldwide to achieve board certification from the American and International Board of Hair Restoration Surgery. He and his hair restoration treatments have been featured on such programs as Today, Good Morning America, the CBS Morning Show, The Doctors, CNN, and more. I'd like to welcome my good friend, Dr. Alan Bauman, to the Holistic Plastic Surgery Show. It's a pleasure having you on the show, Alan. Thank you so much for coming on.
Tony, it's really great to be here. Thanks so much for inviting me.
Okay, well, let's get started by talking about your background and how you became one of the nation's premier experts in hair loss and hair restoration. So what path did you take, Alan, to get you to where you are today?
So it's kind of an interesting story. I guess my first education in hair loss was watching my dad lose his hair. Mm-hmm. So I was a teenager at the time, a high school student, and I watched my dad deal with thinning, a comb over, lotions and potions, and eventually some pretty extensive hair loss. He eventually ended up with a hair replacement system over time. But I saw the trauma that he went through, and my sister and I are probably responsible for a lot of the stress that caused him to lose his hair, maybe. But it always stuck with me, and I always liked my own hair. When I was a student in college and even in medical school, I grew longer hair, and I love my hair. But my first love was always surgery, and mm-hmm. plastic surgery was the first thing I was attracted to in medicine. I guess it was a close friend of the family who had introduced me to surgery. He was a prominent plastic surgeon in New York, and he kind of took me under his wing and guided me through the process. Of course, I went to medical school, internship and residency in surgery, but always focused back on the cosmetic end of things. Mm-hmm. So I was attracted to the artistry of hair transplantation when I met a patient who had had it done, and I was unable to tell. Wow. That he had a hair transplant. So that was back in the mid-1990s. So that was quite a bit of time ago.
And you've really been focused on hair for the last 20 or so years, correct?
Correct. Yeah, I saw my first hair transplant in 1995. And it was really through a series of traveling to different physicians' offices and attending different conferences at a time where not everybody was doing the state-of-the-art work. And so what struck me about that original patient that I remember seeing so vividly was that his hairline looked great. It didn't look pluggy. Mm-hmm. It didn't look unnatural in any way, shape, or form. And that was a little bit different than what I had had in my mind about a hair transplant. And so I said, maybe I should look into this.
Mm-hmm. And one of the things that we have talked in the past about is, you know, about patients who do come in with just horrible traumatic stories, really, that you think, you know, some people may look at, oh, you know, it's just hair, what's the big deal? But there are some people who are really profoundly impacted by thinning hair and hair loss. And we're not just talking about men, but a lot of women too, correct?
Oh, absolutely. So 80 million Americans out there are struggling with some form of hair loss, probably about 50 million men visibly, 30 million women out there. But it affects everybody differently. You know, at different stages of their life, if they're experiencing hair loss, different things can happen. I mean, of course, if you're a young guy and you're in your 20s and 30s and you're trying to enter the job market or be cool on the social scene and you see yourself looking much older, that's going to have some kind of an effect. Mm-hmm. But if you're a woman, there's no option for thinning hair in the female species, really. If you're a woman out there and you're experiencing shedding, you're experiencing a loss of coverage, you have to change your hairstyle. You're very limited when these things start to happen. And I see it in my practice over the past 20 years, 50% of my patients are women, 50% of my patients are men. So we know it can have a deep, deep psychological effect.
Well, the vast majority of my listeners and viewers are women. So I'd love to focus on women. I know you've done a lot of interviews talking about men because this is something that does affect so many men, especially genetically. But I do see a lot of women who have these issues too. So I'd like to ask you just to kind of go through a typical scenario. So let's say it's somebody who's a listener or a viewer today. She's in her mid-50s, and she's noticing that her hair is thinning. She comes to your office in Florida. Is it Boca?
Sure. We're in Boca Raton, Florida. Now, she may also reach out and contact me long distance online. Many of our women and men also start with the online consultation process first to get a little bit of a handle on what's going on. They may submit photos even before I see them physically in the office.
Okay, so let's say she does walk into your office in Boca and she tells you, look, I'm a healthy person, you know, I've seen my physician, I get all my exams and everything, and my labs in general test normal, but I'm losing my hair. What process do they go through now to diagnose their issue and to get treated?
Right, so most of the patients that we see, most of our women have already been down the road of their dermatologist, their OBGYN, their family practice physician, they've had multiple blood tests. I mean, many of them have been all the way around the block and back getting all kinds of tests up the wazoo to figure out why they're losing their hair. And it's unfortunate. Well, the good thing is that they don't have a lab value that's out of whack. So that's good news. Most of them have normal lab values. And so what we know is that the vast majority of women with thinning hair are going to have hereditary hair loss. And so the first thing we want to do is get their history. When did this hair loss start to occur? Did it occur after a traumatic event or after the birth of a child? Or is it around the time of menopause? What is going on with their health history? Did they start some new medication or stop some medication like birth control? So we're going to get a very, very holistic picture of what's going on with their whole situation. Did they lose or gain any weight recently? The medical history and the exam of the scalp is where everything starts. So we don't go rushing off to a whole bunch of blood tests until we talk to the patient about what is going on in their scalp, and then we start to examine and measure.
So when you talk about their history, and let's say that they are having a lot of stress, mm-hmm. do you start, to, you know, if the person then tells you, yeah, I just had a divorce, you know, a year or two ago, I've got a sick parent that I've been taking care of, do you start them at that point in trying to deal with stress management, or do you proceed to other things as well?
Well, I do spend a lot of time talking about stress management, obviously, and that's a great point that you can't eliminate stress in the world or in your body or in yourself sometimes, but you have to learn how to manage it better. And we do spend a lot of time at least identifying that there's a situation there that might be exacerbating the hair loss and other health factors, of course. I mean, the whole body can respond to spiking cortisol levels and whatnot. But so we do talk about that. But you know, we're also going to focus on exactly what's going on with their scalp because we want to look and measure. We want to measure some different areas. We're going to take a close look and see what's going on in the back of their scalp where things should normally be very healthy. Mm-hmm. Right? The diameter and the density of hair should be good in that zone. And we're going to measure with a hair check device, a cross-sectional bundle measurement in that zone. We're going to measure and compare that to areas in the crown or the frontal area or wherever they're having some thinning, maybe even in the temples a little bit, could be receding. So we want to look for those signs and symptoms, get the full history and physical exam underway.
So specifically then, what are you looking for when you're measuring those things? You know, if they're thicker in one area than another, is it more of a diagnostic where it's going to tell you what a potential cause could be, or is it more of a treatable thing, clinical thing, where you say, okay, because they're thinner here, we put hair here, or we treat this area? Is there anything that you can get then just from measuring like that of what maybe their cause could be?
Absolutely. So as soon as we start, because we're going to measure and we're going to look. So those are the two basic things that we're going to do on the scalp when the patient first comes in. So when we start to measure, when we compare the good, what's supposed to be the good areas with the others, that will actually help deliver the diagnosis. Because if things are super good in the back and then they get weaker as you go to the front or the temples, that's a hereditary pattern. Now that hereditary pattern may be exacerbated by other things, like, you know, the stressful situation we just discussed, or a change in their diet, or their sleep habits, or their nutrition, or medication they've started, or something like that. But underlying, there's going to be some hereditary condition.
Okay.
We also want to look at the scalp, because we want to see, is the scalp healthy? Are there patches of loss? Or is it more just a miniaturization of hair follicles, a weakening of the hair quality and quantity? So when we look with the microscope, what we're looking at, hopefully in the back of the scalp, is a forest of all oak trees, dense, thick forest. And then as we go to other areas, we're going to look and see, are all the hair fibers looking about the same in caliber, or is there some differences? And if the hair fibers are starting to weaken, that means the follicles are weakening in that area. That means that there's something happening. We can also say that there's something that we can do about it. So many of our treatments can be done at a time before the follicles are dead and gone. So it is also diagnostic, as you say, and it leads us to the therapy as well.
Mm-hmm. So just to kind of, before we get into the actual treatments, are there any dietary supplements or dietary changes that you recommend for patients who are experiencing the thinning hair?
Well, the first and I guess most important thing is to make sure they're not on some kind of a crash diet, a fad diet, where they're on caloric restriction, because the body is built in such a way to help itself survive. And if you're not providing good nutrition to your body, things that are considered like luxury items like hair are not going to grow all that well. So if you've lost 15 to 20 pounds over the past, 8 to 10 months, that is usually a pretty significant amount of weight loss that could seriously cause some hair loss along with it.
Okay. So,
that's a caloric restriction. Obviously, yeah. Your body is trying to conserve. And listen, your body works really hard to grow hair. I mean, there's a lot of energy input into follicles to grow hair on your scalp and other places too. But your body wants to work hard at that. You have to provide good nutrition.
And do you ever
there are some good supplements?
Do you recommend biotin or any of those types of things too?
Yeah. So even though, and I just had this discussion and debate with a dermatologist who's very well known, that there's not a lot of science on biotin, but everybody seems to kind of know that biotin is for hair, skin, and nails. Mm-hmm. And I will tell you, over the past 20 years, we've seen it. We know the nails get stronger and thicker. You can measure that. And there's a lot of literature on that as well. If you feed biotin super mega doses to horses, their hooves grow stronger and faster and thicker. So it makes a little bit of sense there. And their fur, their hair fibers also improve. And the same is true in humans, especially for women. If they're trying to torture their hair with all these different styling products, heat and chemicals and color and you name it, blow drying, straightening treatments, you want to build strong keratin fibers of hair. Mm-hmm. So I'm all for biotin. We prescribe 10,000 micrograms of medical grade per day. And it's not expensive. It's like less than $1 a day for my version, the Bauman MD version. And, that's one of our most popular nutritionals in the practice. And we measure the improvements. We measure the decrease in hair breakage.
Oh, so that's a good thing that people can do that's obviously completely non-invasive. And how do you compare something like that?
There's two others also. There's two other favorite nutritionals that I have.
Yeah. And what are those? I know one of the things, well, let me bring it up before you mention those, because this may be one. Have you used Viviscal?
For sure. Anybody that's tuned into Dateline NBC around 2004 knows that one of our Follicle 5 patients who were featured on that show used Viviscal. And that was at a time when it was not well known here in the U.S., but very popular in Europe. Okay. And probably one of the first celebrities was Finola Hughes from General Hospital to promote the Viviscal product. But that was before they had all the millions of dollars worth of research now in the clinical literature. Mm-hmm. So Viviscal Professional, which is, for your listeners, is a collagen protein replacement. It's a supplement that's made from fish, actually shark cartilage, sustainable shark cartilage. And it's a daily pill. You actually take it twice a day. And the data shows that there's improvements in density and diameter and tensile strength of hair. And a lot of these studies were done in the laboratory on the bench looking at hair follicles. And a lot of them were done in humans as well. So I would say Viviscal is probably the most well-studied nutritional on the planet right now, and probably one of the most popular.
All right, so that's one of the two that you say we hadn't mentioned yet, right?
Yeah.
All right, what's the third one then?
Okay, so the newest one is called Nutrafol. Have you heard of that?
I've heard of it. I haven't heard a lot of it yet, though.
So Nutrafol is pretty new. It's a pretty innovative approach to the hair loss process. It not only targets what we would say the traditional mechanisms like hormonal imbalance, but it also contains an anti-inflammatory, an antioxidant. It has an adaptogen for stress. So it's got about 20 different, very sophisticated mixture of nutraceuticals in there. And I would say it's a multi-nutraceutical, for lack of a better term.
Okay. Now, would you ever put somebody on all three of those, or is it something where they have to kind of pick?
No, a lot of our patients stack these nutritionals and nutraceuticals together. It's not uncommon. I mean, if you look at a professional athlete, they may take 50 nutritional supplements a day. Mm-hmm. So people who are serious about growing good hair, yeah, they'll stack it up too, for sure. So, and so those are not mutually exclusive.
Okay. So when do you then bring in the treatments? So low light laser therapy is something I know that you've been a big proponent of. The laser cap is one I know that you have been a big fan of and have promoted on national TV and things. If these nutritional supplements and the stress reduction, that type of stuff doesn't work, is the next step then low light laser for people who are having thinning hair? Or is there something that they should do before that?
So, first of all, the most important thing, right? So let's back up for a second, is the measurements. So we know exactly how much hair is growing in each zone, and then the follow-up appointments, which are in 90 days. Now, some people will start with just easy peasy, simple stuff like the nutraceuticals. Some people will do more at one time, mm-hmm. and that's totally fine. So I would say the next step would be lasers and topicals. So those kind of in the same category in terms of things that I might prescribe next.
Okay.
And so laser light therapy is a great treatment because it's non-chemical, non-invasive, has absolutely zero chance of side effects, none whatsoever. And low-level laser therapy has been a part of my practice since the 1990s.
And I've seen many, many studies, you know, I've written about it in my book, The Age Fix, that low-light laser therapy works. I mean, it does. It seems to then, and correct me if I'm wrong, it helps stimulate follicles go into growth phase, doesn't it?
Absolutely. And it helps them stay in the growth phase, and it provides energy to the hair follicles in the form of ATP, which is, you know, is a cellular fuel that follicles use to do their business.
Okay. So I'm definitely giving out the right information. So that's
yeah, no, that's good. You're right in there. I mean, look, I don't know about you, but when I was in medical school, you know, in the 1990s, nobody taught me about photomedicine and how visible light could affect a human cell. And, you know, when I spoke about this to my colleagues, even my hair restoration colleagues years ago in the late 1990s and the early 2000s, I mean, the skepticism was insane. I mean, it was laughing me off the stage. And I said, no, there's good science here, because I know from general surgery that low-level laser therapy works for wound healing. Mm-hmm. So it's got a physiologic effect.
Yeah.
And we're now seeing, today it's solid science.
And we're seeing it so much more now. And I was the same thing. I remember years ago I had a patient ask me about blue light and red light. And I thought, what is this nonsense that they're asking me about? And now we know blue light can help with acne. Red light can help with aging. And I mean, it's definitely.
It's a real deal.
Yeah. And it's, you don't have to feel a laser for it to work. That's
perfect.
That's the great thing. So low light laser therapy. Now you're a fan of the laser cap.
Sure.
Are there other ones that you recommend as well? Or is that kind of the one that you have the most experience with that you feel most comfortable with?
We have the most experience with laser cap. It was invented by Dr. Michael Rabin, who lives in Cleveland, Ohio. Super great guy. Very, very innovative. Always on the top of the technology. And he was the first to bring that to market. And, you know, his devices are now warranted for the lifetime. They've got hundreds of diodes, so they're very powerful. They fit underneath a baseball cap. They're super portable. They're light. And patients do very, very well. The other part of it is that we did a clinical trial with laser cap, and we had really great results in our female population in that clinical trial. It was about a year or two ago. We had over 100 women come through that trial with excellent results on low-level laser.
How long does it take somebody using a low-light laser device like the laser cap to start seeing their hair actually thickening?
Yeah. So in order to see something changing in the mirror, no matter what you do, and this is a great point, whether you're doing a topical medication, whether you're doing laser, or whether you're doing a nutritional supplement, even if you're getting something over the counter, it's going to take a long time because hair grows super slow, about a third of a millimeter a day, a quarter to a half an inch a month. It's going to take you 12 weeks to get an inch. It's going to take you a year to get this much, you know? So it takes 6 to 12 months to see anything.
Okay.
Even a hair transplant takes a full year to grow in. Mm-hmm. So most people don't have that kind of patience. They expect it in 6 days, you know?
Yeah, exactly. So the lesson is to be patient.
Months.
Just because you're not seeing it right away doesn't mean it's not working.
Right. And that's why the critical step then is the measurements that we do at the 90-day point. Not to say that the measurements are going to be off the charts phenomenal, but they're going to start to trend in the right direction, and they're going to reinforce the fact that you're getting a result and that you can expect to see those results. If you continue the treatment, you'll see them in the mirror in another 3 months, which will be the 6 month timeline.
So as far as the continuing on, as far as the medications, we've all heard about Rogaine, you know, minoxidil, and they have different strengths for women and men, and those are over the counter. There's also Propecia, which typically is just used for men. Do you stray from any of those guidelines with any of your patients, or is it pretty straightforward from where you're coming from in that, once again, there's a strength for Rogaine for women, they should stick to that, the men have a stronger strength, and then the only men get Propecia?
Okay. Well, you don't know me that well, I guess, because I don't stick to anything. here's the thing. So for 15 years, we knew that Rogaine was greasy and gooey and messy. And if you're a female patient out there or a male with any more than this much hair length, Rogaine is a mess on your hair. And worse than that, 30% of patients are actually allergic. They develop some kind of a dermatitis in response to the vehicle that the Rogaine is dissolved in. So Rogaine has been rated by Consumer Reports as the least popular, or your most disappointing hair growth treatment ever in the world. And it probably has to do with those factors and the fact that minoxidil doesn't penetrate very well. So what's the solution? Well, the solution is to go seek out compounding pharmacists who are more clever than I am in the chemistry lab and to figure out how to make minoxidil non-greasy, not gooey, penetrate better, and become more powerful of an effect on the follicle. And that's what we found in a product called Formula 82M. And I've used Formula 82M, which is a compounded version of minoxidil, in literally 7,000 patients. And we've been, we've been using it for over 10 years. And Formula 82M is by far the most powerful topical I've ever seen. And we'll talk about some of the side effects you can see from minoxidil. But and it's applicable for both men and for women. But the best thing about it is that it goes on very quick and easy. It's a drop tanner bottle. You put it right on the scalp. You don't have to massage it. You don't have to get it all over your hair. And it absorbs super quick. It's going to be dry. So it's a really, really user-friendly, if you will, version of the minoxidil Rogaine that you would usually get over the counter.
So how would somebody get this? Do they have to go through your office for it? Is there one compounding pharmacy in the whole country that makes this?
Yeah. So, I mean, you could look up the recipe and see the ingredients, but the secret recipe, and I'm not privy to it either, is how they mix it together, because it's an emulsification process, which means how they blend it together to make it non-greasy, not gooey. So it's not just, you know, all the ingredients in the chocolate chip cookies. It's, you got to know how to mix it together and fold it and bake it, and so to speak.
Okay.
So yes, there's one pharmacy that does it, but there's many physicians that prescribe it. You know, I happen to be the top prescriber, because we are very good at tracking our results with our patients. We get great results with them. Mm-hmm. And we also can do multi-therapy, you know, so maybe that plus something else might work nice.
Do you still then
works great with laser.
You still use a different percentage of that with women than with men then, right?
No. So everybody gets 5% plus the Retin-A.
Oh, really?
It also contains a mild anti-androgen, oleinolic acid, which is a common organic compound that you see in acne, some acne products. It has a mild anti-inflammatory in it, and it's got a couple of other really special ingredients to kind of help the health of the skin as you apply it. So it's very sophisticated. But no, I use 5% for women. As you may know, 5% is FDA approved for women now, but we've been using 5% in women for many, many, many years.
Okay.
And I do recommend it twice a day.
Okay. What are your thoughts on Propecia?
So Propecia, as you know, is FDA approved for men. It targets the main hormone that is the trigger for male pattern hair loss, DHT, dihydrotestosterone. It does that very effectively in men, 90% success rate. Now, when it first came out in 1998, they tried to test it a little bit on women, and they found that only about 50% of postmenopausal women responded to Propecia or finasteride, which is the main active ingredient, now available off-label, now available generically and also in compounded forms. So what happened over the past, I would say, 8 to 10 years is genetic testing. And so what does that mean? The reason why many women didn't respond to finasteride is because not all women have androgen-sensitive hair follicles. So what we want to do in our discussion and evaluation of our female patients, regardless of age, is to try to dig down and see if they are androgen sensitive or not, meaning that they're responsive to the tiny amount of male hormones that are in their body. And so things like acne and hirsutism, which is hair on the face, and other issues, infertility, as well as hair loss are all related to androgen sensitivity in some cases. All of those are together. Mm-hmm. We can actually do a genetic test to determine if a woman is androgen sensitive. Mm-hmm. And what I've determined, what I've found out, is that if we exclude those women, let's say postmenopausal women, so it's safe, you know, we don't have to worry about childbearing and all that business. So we exclude the women who are not androgen sensitive, and we take the women that are, if we prescribe finasteride to them, they very often get a nice positive response to it. So I think the genetic testing has really helped us aim towards those patients who are more likely to respond to the finasteride and other anti-androgen therapies, because there's other things we can do too.
That's great. Now, when do you start bringing in the actual invasive procedures? You know, and there are obviously the hair transplant is something that has changed a lot over the last few years. But also PRP is something that really has made a lot of news in the last few years as well. People injecting platelet-rich plasma, basically, for those of you listeners or viewers who don't know what that is it's drawing blood from a person, spinning it down, taking the platelets, which are rich in growth factors, and injecting that into the scalp. At what point do you bring in, let's say, that type of a procedure?
So we may talk about PRP. First of all, a lot of patients may come to me for PRP because I've been doing platelet-rich plasma for hair regrowth since 2008. So we have thousands of patients that we've treated successfully with PRP. And we can measure those results, and you know, we can have shown that PRP done the right way can have a dramatic impact on hair regrowth, which is super cool. But that may come up in the discussion immediately. If someone knows or has tried maybe those other types of non-invasive therapies, or they've tried the other chemical therapies, or they have a laser at home, or they've been doing topical minoxidil, and they really want to just give it a boost, we look at the scalp. We're looking for areas of miniaturization, and we might suggest PRP in those cases. And you know, if the follicles are dead and gone, and this comes back to the original evaluation, kind of circling back for a moment, if the follicles are depleted of density, meaning that the trees in the forest are gone, then you're not likely to get too much of an impact from these non-invasive treatments. I consider PRP non-invasive, it's non-surgical, it's just an injection, but that's, you know, that's how we perceive it in our practice. But PRP is a very, very nice treatment option when done properly to get a really good boost of hair growth. But so, you have to do it the right way. Not all of PRP is created equal.
And how often do you perform those injections, and how long do the results last if you do PRP injections? Because my understanding with it is it's not a permanent thing. You inject the person once and hey, their hair is thicker and they never have to have it done again.
Correct. So this is not a permanent fix like a hair transplant. This is something that's going to be required. The way that we do it, and I'll talk about extracellular matrix, which is something that we add to the PRP to give it a stronger and longer effect. But those ways that we do the PRP allow our patients to achieve 10 to 20 months of boost, meaning that they're going to get a hair growth response for that period of time. Most patients will need it annually. Some patients will get a year and a half to 2 years. And then I have, unfortunately, other few patients who need it every 6 months.
Okay, so that's actually...
But basically, about a year is pretty typical. But remember, there's no rule. So what the rule is to measure. If you don't take a baseline measurement, then you won't know how the improvement is going. You won't know when it's plateauing. And you also won't know when it's starting to drift down. That's the time to do the next treatment.
Okay, so really following up and getting those measurements being super helpful in evaluating just how often to have these things done and really how things are working for you.
Correct. Like, for example, today we did several PRP treatments on a number of different patients. And I have a cell counter in the office. It's a hematology device. It's about the size of a large microwave oven. And what that does is it does a counting through electrophoresis of how many platelets per microliter there are in a blood sample and the PRP sample. And I can compare those. So before we even start to spin the blood, we know what the platelet count is to start with in the whole blood. And we know through the spinning process, and I have a number of different ways that we can spin the blood. We've determined there's a special set of kits and devices that enable us to get the highest concentration and highest volume of platelets. We know exactly what the platelet concentrate is in the final product because I measured it right before we do the injection.
So
everybody's different, the point is.
And what really I think where people who are watching and listening here are hopefully realizing is the amount of science that Dr. Bauman has put into hair restoration, because there are a lot of, as you and I know, centers all across the country that are being staffed by physicians who are moonlighting there. They're ER doctors, family doctors, internists, God knows what type of doctor. And they do hair transplant and they may inject PRP, but they don't necessarily have all the science and all this technology behind it. They're not a hair transplant expert like you are, where you really know the science and you're doing the research and you're at that cutting edge. I mean, there are other people who may benefit off what you teach, but they don't really have quite all of that going on.
Right. They may not have the knowledge and they may not have the equipment. I mean, it's an expensive bit of equipment to know to figure out how many platelets you're injecting is not a simple process.
Exactly.
And even when it comes to the extracellular matrix, I mean, that's something that hair restoration physicians have been doing for many years, is adding things like A-cell, which is derived from porcine bladder, pork bladder. It's a powder. Or using what we do is, it's called Bio-D, and that's a placental tissue extract that's added to the PRP. And I think that's a really critical step that gives the PRP this big longevity. Mm-hmm. Because without it, I know, I've measured it. You know, if you do one treatment of just plain PRP, you're only going to get about 4 to 8 weeks of boost, and then it's going to start to dip down again. Mm-hmm. So if you go to your typical dermatologist down the block and you say, yeah, inject me with PRP in my hair, that means you're signing up for a series of 3 to 6 treatments for just this year alone.
Mm-hmm. So
that could be a hassle. It could be expensive.
And so by utilizing the technology that you are, obviously you're getting people much more out of what essentially, I mean, it's a minimally invasive procedure, but it still is, you're still getting injected. It's not.
It's an injection.
Exactly. Yeah. So, you know, you and I.
And also, you know, the other thing, Tony, is that a lot of our local dermatologists are doing PRP. They're doing it without local anesthesia, which is insane. I mean, that's going to hurt badly.
Yeah.
It takes us literally 6 minutes to numb the entire scalp with an ouchless protocol. And that's the way that we do it for our hair transplants. We do it for our PRP. And obviously, we do it every day. So we're pretty good at it. But you should have zero pain from your PRP. If you had a painful PRP, I'm telling you it wasn't done right.
Okay. Super important. So this is something that you and I both know, but a lot of people I don't think really, lay people really understand, is at what point do you need to have a hair transplant? Okay. So there are all these options that we have for thinning hair.
Sure.
You know, and people say, well, with all these options, why does anybody need to have a hair transplant? So can you explain to them what are those situations where, unfortunately, low light laser therapy won't work, PRP won't work, you know, the supplements won't work? When do they have to really consider actual surgery?
Right. So with all this dental prevention, why does anybody have to have a cavity drilled? The problem is that most people come in to seek my advice and my opinions at a point where a lot of follicles are already dead and gone. So the analogy is that if you came in before you noticed the problem was severe, the chances are pretty good that we could protect and enhance existing hair follicle functioning with everything we just talked about, topicals, lasers, PRP, nutrition, stress reduction, and so forth. But unfortunately, and it's just the way human nature is, we wait until things get worse. And so when things are clinically bad, they look bad in the mirror, sometimes the density is very low. And in those cases, we're going to look with the microscope first, of course, to see what's the density going on there. Are we seeing weaker, thinner, wispier hairs that are just not growing well? Or are we seeing that depleted forest of hair where we got to do some replanting? And it's very common. One of the most common areas that we treat with hair transplants is the temple areas, because women can actually recede quite a bit and look more, unfortunately, look masculine when their hairline recedes. And so very often we'll transplant those areas because the density and the quality of the hair is very, very poor in that area. And having the temple areas restored in a very, very feminine way is beautiful. It's gorgeous. Beautiful result. Not a big procedure. Takes a single day.
And so what I tell my patients who ask me about that, and I don't do hair transplants, you know, I send a lot of patients to you, actually.
Well, thank you so much.
It's pretty straightforward. Is there's a difference between thinning hair and a bald spot. If the area is bald, then there's nothing you can do to regrow hair there. You know, that's where you have to do a transplant. But if the hair is still there, it's just thin, then you may be able to get that hair thicker and to, you know, improve the quality and the thickness of the hair in that area.
Correct. And sometimes, honestly, we need a little bit of both, you know, that we're dealing with a zone that's depleted of some hair. And then there's an area right there where it's also thinning and weakening. And then there's another area right next to it that's at risk.
Yeah.
So, you know, very often we will combine the therapies. We'll be doing a hair transplant on the same day as a PRP, if need be.
So
a lot of women, also a lot of women are coming in for hairline lowering because a lower hairline also more feminine, frames the face more aesthetically. They don't want to have this high receded brow. That's not in vogue. It's not in fashion. So very often we can restore the hairline using a minimally invasive hair transplant approach. And I know why you're getting all those calls about hair.
Why is that?
Well, that's because you were part of the wave of excitement about NeoGraft.
Exactly.
Way back when. Yeah. And so, obviously your prominence on a lot of the national news programs, Rachel Ray and so forth, and CBS, I think that's where we met each other. Yep. We've talked about NeoGraft as an innovative, game-changing tool in the industry. That was 10 years ago or more, I think, 2007, 2008. But that was the first motorized device that was able to assist a hair transplant surgeon like me to take the individual follicles one at a time without having to make a scalpel incision.
Exactly.
And so it changed the industry big time.
So let me just, for those people watching, listening, who aren't familiar with what we're talking about, their hair transplant has undergone many different stages. And so a long time ago, they would do basically these hair plugs that still people are afraid of, that you're going to have literally doll's hair type of hair. So that's not done typically anymore. What happened after that is these what are called micrographs, where it would be grafts of one to maybe three or four hair follicles at a time. And what typically doctors would do is literally cut a strip at the back of the scalp out where the hair is thicker, and then they would cut those little strips into tiny little, one to three to four or so hair follicles, and then make tiny little pokes into the area they're going to put the hair, then plant those hair into those areas. And that worked well because instead of having these big plugs of hair, you'd have one or two or three follicles coming out at a time and look much more natural. But the problem with that technique is that people would end up with a big scar on the back of their head that people didn't like. So now Dr. Bauman, Alan's talking about NeoGraft, which is something that I was aware of once again when it came out, is a way to actually remove that hair, literally follicle by follicle. So it's follicle unit extraction. That's what it's called, right? FUE,
right.
Follicle unit extraction, where you take it out hair by hair and get rid of this long kind of linear scar in the back of your scalp. But there's even more going on now since then that's really exciting. So can you talk about some of these exciting things going on now with robotics and that type of thing in hair transplant?
Yeah, so follicular unit extraction, or FUE, is the technique. That's the technique that we use, as you said, to take the individual follicular units or groups of hairs out of the back of the scalp individually without leaving a scar line, no linear scar whatsoever, and never stitches or staples being used back there. So it's a much more comfortable procedure. But it is exceptionally tedious. So it does take a lot of time, effort, and energy to actually do it. And we've harvested in my practice over 2 million FUE grafts manually with the devices like NeoGraft and others. But the good news is that a lot of this technology now is being assisted by robotics. So I have to be one of the practices in the country that has an ARTiS robotic-assisted FUE system. And this is a big refrigerator size instrument that has a head on it about the size of a football. And it can, if you shave the scalp in a small area, it can actually pinpoint and identify each and every hair follicle in that zone. It knows with micron level precision the angle, the orientation, the position of those hairs. And it will work with a very tiny instrument, smaller than the tip of a ballpoint pen, to help us extract those follicles. So it's really, really cool technology. It's exceptionally safe for the patient and comfortable. Patient's just sitting, basically just leaning over almost like a desk with his head on a pillow while the work is being done with the robot in the back. And it's a comfortable process, and it goes very, very fast when that robot is up to speed. So super cool technology, and I tell my patients, hey, when that thing's up and running, it's like Star Trek in here, You're going to hear a lot of whirring and buzzing and whirring and such, but we're going to get those follicles, and we're going to get them quick.
And it's funny because that you say that kind of the Star Trek and the quick thing, it's, I've done hair transplant in my training. I don't do it in practice. And we used to joke, I hated doing it. I'll tell you, I don't know how you do this surgery for as long as you have, because I found it so incredibly tedious. And what we would do is we would, cut the strip of scalp out. We would have a couple of assistants whittling the hairs down, which I did it for a while. And I thought, oh my gosh, like just kill me now. This is so tedious. Then you'd make little holes in the area, stick the follicle in, then take another hair follicle, stick it in the one next to it. But then the one that I just put in pops back out, and it was just, I mean, it drove me nuts. I hated doing the procedure. We used to joke that it was like a little sweatshop in there. We'd have, you know, this table or two or three people would be cutting it, and then the doctor and the assistant would be trying to put the hairs in. And so it's so good now that these procedures are so much more technologically advanced that not only can you get a better result, but you can make it easier on the patient and on the surgeon as well.
Yeah, it is a labor of love. I mean, I'm blessed with an amazing staff. I have 10 surgical technicians which assist me. I have no other physicians in the office. I do have nurse practitioners and PAs who will assist me with these procedures. But it's really exciting when everything is running and working together. You know, we get about 20 man hours of work done on a patient before they go home and have dinner. So it's pretty exciting when everything is working together between the robot and everything else. But the robot is the coolest surgical instrument on the planet. I say, you know, it's the most sophisticated semi-autonomous surgical instrument. And I got one right over there. It's super cool.
So his name is Dr. Alan Bauman. He is an expert in hair loss and hair restoration. He is the country's leading expert in this. And as you can tell by listening to this interview, this guy knows his stuff. I mean, it's fascinating information. We really have only just touched the surface of hair restoration. And I really wanted to try to give my audience just a big overview of what options are available. And so you've done a great job doing that. His website is baumanmedical.com. It's B-A-U-M-A-N medical, all one word, baumanmedical.com. He's located in Boca Raton, Florida. Sees patients from all around the country, because I know I've sent a lot of patients from Michigan down to see you. I'd like to ask you one question, though, before we're all done with this interview, is if you could give one piece of advice for the listeners and the viewers who are watching and listening today, and they've got some issues with hair loss, what piece of advice would you give them?
The most important piece of advice I can give to someone who is out there struggling with hair thinning or hair loss, or maybe at risk for hair loss, is seek out a physician who can examine you, understand your condition, and provide appropriate treatments and care and follow up. That's really the critical step. So, you know, being credentialed, American Board of Hair Restoration Surgery, the International Society of Hair Restoration Surgery has a fellow level, which I'm a member of, and the International Alliance of Hair Restoration Surgeons and so forth. You know, but do your due diligence, check out the reviews, get that consultation, and it's probably not going to be the guy down the block from you at the top level of this field. So, you know, do your due diligence, check it out, and if you have a question or need a second opinion, then contact me, reach out and give me a call, or click submit on the web form.
And he does online consultations as well. His website, once again, is baumanmedical.com. He is an expert in hair restoration, hair loss, and he can help you no matter what your issue is with your hair. Thank you so much for coming on.
Hey, thanks so much for having me, Tony. Really, it's been a pleasure.
I think it's been real educational, and love to have you back on. We'll get into even more detail sometime in the future.
Yeah, let's ask your listeners for some questions, and we'll answer them next time.
Sounds great. All right, thank you. Well, I'm Dr. Anthony Yoon, America's Holistic Plastic Surgeon. This is the Holistic Plastic Surgery Show. We'll see you next time.
Do you want to look 10 years younger without having surgery? Well, my best-selling book, The Age Fix, will tell you how. I spent the past 17 years learning the secrets to turning back the clock and have written all the best of these secrets in this book. This includes the Age Fix Diet, simple changes to what you eat that can make a huge difference in your appearance. I'll share with you a simple skincare routine to keep aging and wrinkles at bay. And I'll share with you the best secrets to treat every single beauty and aging problem there is, from age spots to wrinkles, saggy skin to bad breath, saddlebags to hair loss. And almost all of these can be effectively treated without surgery. So are you ready to turn back the clock and kick Father Time's backside? If so, check out The Age Fix. Now, if you purchase it on my website, dryoon.com, you'll get over $10 off the cover price, free shipping, and you'll receive several free gifts, including a bonus chapter that you can only get by purchasing the book there. Thank you for making The Age Fix such a huge success.